What is the safest work of art in the world? How do I judge if a work of art is great? And did a gallery screw up? I will answer these three questions in the very first casual Q&A. This is very, very different than my normal videos on this channel. If you're here to see me feature a specific contemporary artist and an exhibition and a larger concept about how to look at contemporary art, stay tuned for next week. Make sure you're subscribed because right now my 3D printer is running as we speak to print out some little things that I'm going to use to demonstrate an exhibition on the next video, which deals with super minimalism. It's going to be great. But for now, I'm going to answer a few questions that were in the comments of a previous video. If you have a question at any time during this video, simply comment the question below and hashtag it Q&A. If it is hashtagged Q&A, that means you want it answered in a video. Otherwise, I will just answer it in the comments. Paul Watson asks, hey, Paul, thanks for watching. What would you say creates safe art or commercial art? I have been thinking about what the artwork would be, what the color, the texture, the size, the type of art. If someone had to compile all the most popular artworks together and then separate the pleasing parts and then create one work of art, now that would be interesting because could you create an antithesis of that piece and still call it art? Good news, Paul. There's someone crazier than me who has already attempted to answer this question. His name is Dennis Dutton. He did a TED Talk all about it many years ago. I first heard excerpts of it on the TED Radio Hour, which is my favorite podcast. And so I've put the link to that podcast episode in the comments because they've edited his stage talk to a nice like 7 minute talk of what he discovered the ideal painting would be. I'm not even going to ruin it for you because it's only 7 minutes and he paints a picture of what everyone would agree is the best painting that could be that people 1,000 years ago and 1,000 years from now in every single culture would like and links it to kind of greater ideas of human evolution, which is both fascinating and not surprising at all. But your question itself made me think of two things. One is, are those YouTube videos where someone buys everything at McDonald's and then puts it in a blender? And so they have like McDonald's in total in a blender.
Doesn't look that appetizing. You got things like this, this is a fillet of...
One of the things that makes contemporary art specifically so great are what the artist omits. In the same way that comedy is more about the spaces between the words than the words themselves, great contemporary art is about what is almost lacking or missing from the work of art. And so this idea of picking the best parts, I know you didn't mean it literally, and then combining them would just end up with a McDonald's smoothie. Okay, Cultura Big asks, Cultura, hey, Thanks for subscribing and watching and commenting. How do you put a work of art in a very good, poor, or bad category? I appreciate that you have not just picked good or bad, but ranges of those. Is it because of your feelings or previous readings or reviews or the gallery or everything or none of the above? I actually have a really simple and concrete answer to this that will shock you because it is so easy and straightforward. But first, and thank you for this opportunity, I need to get really complicated. The word art means several different things. Similar to the word love. I'm in love with my wife, and man, I love that new ice cream shop. My wife's not jealous of the ice cream shop. Do you know what I'm saying? This video will be revolutionary because I don't think anyone has ever done this, to my knowledge. I personally, these are my opinions and my categories, break the word art down into four categories. Category number one, I would call genius. We call something art when it is so good, it seems magically impossible. I go to a restaurant and the burger was so good that that chef is an artist. So artist is just a synonym for genius, and the things that that person does, we call art. The second definition of art is any object that is created using materials you could purchase from an art supply store, meaning it is a material-based definition. This is why when a three-year-old kid takes a crayon and scribbles on a piece of paper, we call that art. The kid is doing art. It's a definition of art that is as true as all of the other definitions, but it's a separate definition that only refers to the material that is being used. The third definition of art is probably the most popular, the one that I use the most, though most people have not heard it clearly stated in a sentence. So get ready for this to use at parties. Art is an object whose aesthetics supersede its function on purpose. That's it. So I will use the example of a spoon. There's a spoon designer who's in charge of making spoons interesting to look at. And at one point, the spoon designer says, "Do you know what would make this spoon particularly cool to look at? Like, what if we cut out the entire middle of the spoon? That would look so good." What has happened in this case is the aesthetics, the quality of it being looked at, which can be beautiful or ugly, but it is just the quality of it being looked at, has out-prioritized the fact that the thing needs to be functional. And that spoon is either garbage, and the designer is going to get fired, or the designer can say, "No, I wasn't trying to make a spoon, I was trying to make art." And it's not just pulling a word out of the universe as an excuse for being a terrible designer. It's saying, I've purposefully entered into a category of things where their aesthetic quality supersedes their functionality. And so some artists make art that is simply playing with the definition. It's just a commentary on the definition, like this Duchamp sculpture where he took a bicycle wheel and a stool and by attaching them in this format has removed the functionality of both things. It's just a clever comment on that definition of art. But it's also any painting, particularly ones on canvas. Fabric we use for clothing and for bed sheets and quilts, and now you've painted it to such a degree where you're not going to use it for anything. It's just going to sit on the wall as a functionless object. Its aesthetics have superseded its function on purpose. But again, I'm going to keep coming back to this. It is a separate definition of art. So some people will come to this and say, "You didn't use paint, so it's not art." And I say, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, everybody, you're talking about two different definitions of the word. Let's get straight on the definition of the word first, and then everything will be cleared up." And artwork, by the way, can be all three or all four of these, but let's make sure we're all talking about the same definition when we object to something being called art, or when eventually I get to your question, when I judge how good of a work of art it is, I need to make sure I know which category I'm talking to. And the fourth definition of art is what I call contemporary art. Probably an easier definition for people would be current art history. When I say art, what I mean is this very tiny thread of a conversation that has been happening for hundreds and hundreds of years. So just as a really rapid fire art history to show you what I mean, this dude Cezanne comes along and kind of changes the way that we think about still lives, in that what if it's not just the apples, what if it's also the paint and the painting itself in addition to the apples? And he just breaks that idea a little bit. And then Picasso comes along and says, "I just saw Cezanne, what if we take it here?" And everyone goes, "Wow." And then generations later, Jackson Pollock comes along and says, "I saw this Picasso. What if I do this?" And that is a conversation. It is a chess game that is happening over centuries. And so if you want to kind of jump in the game and try to participate in that conversation, it's a very specific lineage that is completely pointless. As a great analogy, I don't know who the fastest runner in the world is, or the highest jumper in the world is right now, but why aren't they also the number one football player? Wouldn't it make sense that the fastest person in the world would also be the number one football player in the world? Like, besides their preference for which sport they play, it never happens. And the reason it never happens is because football has a set of rules, and we're saying you need to be the best within this set of rules, within this game we're playing. And so the lineage of art history is really a set of rules that is really, really complicated. And you can take years of studying courses in the same way that you can really get into football, of each players and each teams and their statistics and who does better in the rain. And, oh, that person was injured and now they're coming back. The deeper you get into this, the greater interest that the game takes on. And so that when I go to a gallery with someone who's equally knowledgeable in that, and we both go, whoa, like that's a move you just made in this game that's happening over centuries. And so all that to say that I think most museums are for insane football fans who want to see artifacts of the game. So sometimes when you go see a sculpture and it makes no sense and there's no skill, a lot of times that the museum is collecting a moment where someone introduced an idea into the conversation. I don't even remember what the question was. Culture of big. Thanks for staying with me. The answer to your question for me personally is super simple. I have two things, two tests that I run by any work of art to determine if for me personally, I can rate it as being really good. The first question is the photograph test. It has to look better in person than it does in a photograph, which is often the opposite of Instagram. Sometimes in Instagram, you want something to look better in the photograph than it does in real life. But with art, for me personally, if I see an image of it on a website or on Instagram, and then I go to the gallery, it must look better in person than it does in a photograph. Not the same, not worse. And then when I photograph it and I post it to Instagram, I'll have this feeling where I go, oh, it looked better in person. So that's measure number one of me rating a work of art good, is if it's always better in person than it is in a photograph. And my second test, this is very, very, very true if I'm thinking about purchasing the work of art, or if I'm advising people on purchasing specific works of art, this is the most important test. And that is if the second time I view it, it's better than the first time I viewed it. So I will see the show and it doesn't matter. I might hate it the first time. Some of the things I have in my apartment, I hated the first time I saw them. But then I happened to walk by a few days later by chance and I liked it a little bit more. And I said, ooh, I liked it more the second time. And sometimes I really like something the first time and then I go back and you'll either be kind of disappointed or you'll have the same feeling or you'll like it even more. Kind of in the way that great relationships are. You meet someone and they're great and it just keeps getting better and better and better. And that's really what I want from a work of art. And though I can't define the quality that that is, it is something that I check. A great way to continue that conversation or to get deeper or more specifically into it is to send me an image. Anyone, send me an image. It could be a work of art that you have done and you want some feedback on it, or you're at a museum and you photograph something because you're crazy confused. And finally, Philip Pam X. Philip Pam X, thank you for watching and thank you for commenting. I appreciate it. Is the gallery's role to guide visitors through the experience? I am thinking the blind spot you mentioned. Visitors miss everything just because accidentally, I question the choice of this word, but that's another story, stood in the middle of the room. What if the setup of the exhibition was in a way that would inspire or gently guide the visitor? I am so glad you asked this question, because I'm often in a hurry to release those videos while you still have plenty of time to actually go visit the work in person. And so writing the videos can feel a little rushed, and sometimes the message can come off a little off. And I felt in retrospect that the message of that video was not as true to what I was trying to say. I will put up, if I can figure it out, a playlist so people who don't know can see the video that this question is talking about. But first, just to answer your very basic question, is it the gallery's role to guide visitors? No, it is not. It is, and some gallery owners may want to jump in here, but from everyone I've ever talked to in this industry, it is the gallery's job to honor what the artist wants to do. The artist is not just in charge of which works are shown, but how they're shown. I've seen shows where the lights are off. I have seen shows where you have to look through peek holes to view paintings that when you would buy the paintings, they would just be regular paintings. But the artist has installed something weird. An artist is choosing how their work is shown in every sense of the word when it is in a gallery. When it's in a museum, it's a totally different story because the curator is deciding. And the curator can either work with what the artist's intention was or override that intention. In fact, that one I'm working on right now, where I'm 3D printing myself for the video that's going to be released next week, is talking again about what happens when a curator overrides what the artist wants. But in the gallery situation, understand that the artist is always getting what they want, and the gallery is there to financially support that move for that exhibition. So I walk into every show thinking that whatever's happening here is happening on purpose and with intention. And the video you're specifically talking about, which featured Peter Lind Busk, again, I'll put the link up somewhere so you can watch that full video if you don't know what we're talking about. I talked about a blind spot, a moment, a distance from the painting at which it is completely uninteresting. And I was really trying to say how much I respect that artist pulling that off. How difficult a thing that is to do that would not have happened by accident, and how great and rare of a quality of seeing an object that creating a blind spot smack in the middle, how genius that is. And there's this quality, it's particularly in art of the Lower East Side, that requires an extreme amount of effort to kind of unlock a work of art. A prime example right now is the work of Alex Israel. I filmed this yesterday so you can see how one would enter the gallery. There's no marking at all. You have to know which buzzer to hit. When you go up the steps, it's an unmarked door. There's no way anyone else would know. But when you're inside, there's this incredibly expensive hologram. It is the same technology that made the Tupac hologram or the Michael Jackson hologram on stage. No one knows it's there. In fact, I love playing that game a little bit too. So though it's in my newsletter, if you subscribe to my newsletter, I'm recommending it at the very bottom of my newsletter. But notice I have not Instagrammed it yet or put a thing in my YouTube video, because there's something about that kind of art where it's so joyful to discover it. To be like, is this the door? Wait, is this the door? And then you hit it and it's this rush of, I found something. And in the work of Peter Lind Busk, that discovery doesn't happen through an unmarked door. It happens by just take three steps. And if you exert that level of effort and you put that much faith into this artist on the wall, like the work explodes and you think, wow, thank God I walked closer to this thing. So you get really excited like a kid and walk around. And I like that excitement happens after you've already been in the gallery for 2 minutes, like you don't see that coming. And then on top of that, to do that in two directions, so good. And so I think by picking the word blind spot and bipolar, which has its own negative connotations, by picking kind of a negative word, I didn't mean it as a negative thing. I mean it as a really smart, purposeful, difficult thing that he did to create that blind spot, which leads to like this double moment of surprise and discovery. Thank you for watching, those who watched this far. If you want more of these videos, and or if you have questions that you would like me to tackle, whether it's about critiquing your own work or kind of looking at a work of art that you've always been confused by in a museum, or explaining a section of art history, or talking about how to purchase contemporary art down to the whatever nitty-gritty details you want to know about that, any question at all that I can answer, ask it in the comments with the hashtag Q&A. If it's hashtagged Q&A, that means I will answer it on video. If it is not hashtagged Q&A, I will just answer it in the comments, normal style. No matter what you do, please like, comment, and subscribe if you appreciate what's going on here. And I will see you next week with an official How to Look video with 3D printing and curatorial override, and it will be awesome. So I'll see you next week.